So our second talk is from Simon Variation of Data Simulation.
Yes. Thanks very much for having me. So I'll be talking about, again, variation data simulation, in this case, in an application in Webflow. So generally, knowledge about accurate blood flow, so we're really talking about blood flow in the human body, for example, is critical for a number of clinical decisions. Now, to give you one example, so in this picture, this is a CT scan of the brain. And in the blood, we injected a contrast liquid that allows us to see very clearly where the blood vessels are. So you can see the main blood vessel going into the brain. Splits up into a very smaller blood. But also in the center of the domain, you see this kind of blob. Does anyone know what that could be? It's an aneurysm. Right? So here's another picture. So near the brain, here's this aneurysm. And they actually occur quite often. You can, patients get scanned and you see them. And they are very dangerous and you want to operate them away. There's actually an excellent book by Henry Marsh, which is one of the leading neurosurgeons in Britain. I'm going to read out one section of this book called aneurysms. Aneurysms are small, balloon-like blowouts on the cerebral arteries that can and often do cause catastrophic hemorrhages in the brain. The aim of the operation is to place a minute spring-loaded metal clip across the neck of the aneurysm, just a few millimeters across. Prevent the aneurysm bursting. There's a very real danger that the surgeon, working at several inches depth in the center of the patient's head in a narrow space beneath the brain, will inadvertently burst the aneurysm while it intersects it free from the surrounding brain and blood vessels and tries to clip it. Aneurysms have thin, fragile walls, yet they have high-pressure arterial blood within them. Sometimes the wall is so thin that you can see the swirling dark vortices of blood within the aneurysm, made enormous and sinister by the magnification of the operating microscope. If the surgeon ruptures the aneurysm before he can clip it, the patient will usually die or at least suffer a catastrophic stroke, a fate that can easily be worse than death. So these doctors are faced with the decision if they should operate these aneurysms or not. And it's clear that kind of indicators that kind of quantify the risk of an aneurysm is extremely important. And these indicators, they're very suggestions, and they're mostly based on the flow in the aneurysm, or many of them are based on the flow in the aneurysm. So there are actually measurement techniques that allow us to measure the flow, the blood flow in the aneurysm. So here's an MR magnetic resonance scan. Here's kind of the result that you get. Out of it, zoomed into the aneurysm. So you can see this, there are a few problems with this. It's very coarse, so often the indicators can't be applied to such a coarse solution. So the obvious kind of idea is to use numerical models to produce better results. Kind of the obvious choice is to just use this domain and use the measurements we have here at the boundaries. Drive, for example, in a results model to simulate how the flow is in this interior domain. The problem with this is that the measurements are very coarse and error prone. So here I just integrated the flux and the inflows in the two outflows. And I color mark them in this plot. So if you add the two outflows, you get this dashed green line. If you add the inflow, you get this blue line. So they clearly don't match up. So if you're just trying to kind of use these measurements to try to numerical model, you're already faced with a lot of positions and you have to kind of guess. Right. So this kind of technique that it's described as called interpolation of observations, and it's the common practice for running blood flow simulations today. But there's a lot of other data simulation techniques out there that is often used in weather modeling, for example, ocean modeling, and so on. And one of the most successful ones is the variation data simulation techniques. And that's the goal of our talk today. So we want to bring relational data simulation into blood flow simulation because it has been very successful in other fields. So there has been some publications recently on this topic. Mostly describing the theory and also some applications, but they're only in 2D and steady state models. So we really want to bring it into the 3D and kind of things. So the reason, I believe the reason why this hasn't done yet is because this actually requires an atom model, and it's just a lot more complex than also an implementation model. So generally the idea in the spatial data simulation is that we have one. You have the reality, right? And then you have some kind of measurement device that yields observations. And this measurement device might also have errors, right? So that's kind of the reality side. And then on the right-hand side, we have the communication equivalent. So in particular, we have a model that requires model inputs. These model inputs get then fed into mathematical models that reflects reality. And then we have a virtual measurement device that reflects measurement device that we use in reality also, which then gives us some kind of model observations. And the goal of relational data simulation is to find model inputs such that the difference between these observations and the model observations is minimal. So if we write this down in maths and assign terms to all these kind of boxes, is we end up with an optimization. And we basically, the model inputs are just called G here, so we want to, this is our control. And then our objective is the modeled, so use our state. We have this, I should say, FUG equals 0, this is our PDE, so we model our physics with the PDE. The PDE has G as input and has U as a result. So use our state, it could be the velocity. And then we map the state U through our observation of whether T. So T is basically an implementation of an R machine, for example. And then we obtain the model observations. And so we want to minimize the discrepancy between the model observations and the data that we have under the condition that we satisfy our So that's a very general idea. What you end up with is this kind of PDE constraint optimization, right? We have an objective and then we have So now, very specific to the blood flow case, it looks very similar. So we have an implementation problem, we have this kind of data, and then we have all. Let's go through it step by step. So the model inputs in our blood flow problem is the initial condition and the boundary conditions. Right? We have a time-dependent problem. The initial conditions are unknown, and they're also the boundary conditions are unknown. We have typically observations at a number of time steps. So we just sum our objective is the minimization of the discrepancy over these time steps where we have observations. And then in this case, we assume that we have velocity observations. So U is our velocity at the time step mapped to the observation operator. In this case, we have a very similar observation operator where we just project the velocity solution into observation space. And then we have some regularization term that I'm going to talk about in a second. So this is our objective. Our PDE that models the physics is just normal neighbor slopes, time-dependent neighbor slopes, with our initial condition here. So this is where our first control goes, this is U0. Then we have some boundaries. Here's kind of the domain sketch. So we have an inflow boundary here. We have two outflows on the up here, and then we have walls of our blood vessels. So typically simulated bifurcation of blood vessels. So what we do is we control only the inflow in the outflow, in one of the outflows, and the other one is natural. It's just natural outflow. And the reason why we do that is because if we optimize for all three in an outflow conditions, the optimization might come up with we want to satisfy mass conservation, right? And the optimization in one of the iterations might come up with try to pump in more liquid than it wants to go out. So it's enough to actually convert just two in at the other. Okay, so then now we need, so this is kind of the problem formulation that we end up with. It's quite a complex problem, so we have computation expensive PDE. We have a lot of control, so the initial condition is infinite dimensional control in the infinite dimensional setting. So if you refine your mesh, you end up having more and more control levels that you need to optimize. And then you also have this boundary conditions, so you have controls of every single kind. Right, so then we need to talk about the regularization. Regularization helps us to kind of choose control values that we believe are correct. So in this case, we kind of know that our boundary conditions are relatively smooth in time. So you don't expect that at the inflow, you have a lot of high frequency inflow. And so basically this is what we have here. So our realization consists of the time derivative of the our boundary condition control integrated over time. And so with alpha we can kind of control how much we care about the smoothness of time. So basically if our alpha is small, we fit the data points that we have these green dots exactly. And then if we increase alpha, it gets smoother. We don't mention it exactly anymore, but our control, our boundary control gets smoother. All right, so how do we solve this problem? Now we're going to use Phoenix, we're going to use dot matcher, and we want to use gradient-based optimization to efficiently solve this as the optimization problem. So we do exactly what we really talked about before. So we formulate the reduced problem, which means that we consider our objective as a pure function of the initial condition and the control. So we basically got rid of our PDE constraint because it's implicitly contained here in the solution operator. So U is the velocity that is for the given initial condition and boundary conditions. And then for this problem, the first order optimality condition is just that the gradient of our reduced function is zero. That's what we're solving for. And we solve that with the optimization package containing dot matcher. So basically, this is the loop that we perform. We provide an initial guess for our initial condition in the boundary conditions. Then we solve the forward problem, the neighbor sort system. Then we solve the adjoint system to compute the gradient. Then we feed that information to an optimization package. The optimization package comes up with better control values. And we just continue that until the gradient of J is small in a certain sense. Good. So I want to mention a few implementation challenges that I came across in taking this problem. So the first one is, if you want to do, so Dalton Adjoint currently doesn't support controlling boundary conditions. So, strictly enforced boundary conditions. So Dirichlet boundary conditions that are strictly enforced with Dirichlet BC and Phoenix, you can't differentiate with respect to the Dalton Adjoint. So instead, what I did is I just used the Nietzsche approach. And with the Nietzsche approach, your boundary condition shows up in the Bayesian formulation. And so you just, the boundary terms, just the normal coefficients in the UFL, and then you can use Dolphin Adjoint as usual to compute the derivatives. And these are the additional terms that you need to add to that. So G is our boundary condition terms, and there's some basically three integrals in the momentum equation and one integral in the continuity equation, always over the control surfaces. Probably the most prominent ones is here this stabilization term, so gamma is a user specific value, and then it's basically just the difference between U and G on the boundary. Right? And that term gets bigger and bigger the smaller the final dimensions of the stage of state analysis. So with that, we can optimized for applications. The second challenge was large view problems. So if you look at our functional again, we had this difference. So our function is the sum of all the measurements. So this is of length, it's a sum of length, the number of observations, plus this regularization term. The regularization term was an integral over time. If you discretize it, you end up with the sum of the length and number of time steps. And, well, UFC immediately couldn't handle that. So basically, the solution was to switch to UFX and then fix another bug in UFL to avoid deep recursions. But that, Martin's up, this is now what it's going to be. Next one is fast PD servers. So we constantly, we iteratively need to solve the system over and over again. So we've done some kind of preliminary scaling testing in 3D with three different meshes, two different discretizations, stabilized P1, P1, and data. Just the better oil and time, and then super, just a direct solver in space. These are the kind of values that we get out. Measures increasing number of CPUs. So it's, it doesn't exactly double always, but it's more or less in scaling. And the assembly looks really nice, and the solve obviously blows up because we're using a direct solver. So we're working on using field split methods and iterative solvers to improve this timing for larger problems. The last implementation challenges regarding the boundary controls. So in Phoenix Dyson, we support having functions that just live on the boundary. So for our boundary controls G, we have to store it every single time we need to store a function on the entire domain. And so ideally, we would want to just define a function that just lives on the boundary and use that. So there's definitely a kind of optimization that can be done here. And as far as I know, the decision required. Right, then let's look at some examples. So we start with a 2D test case of a artificial aneurysm here. So we have input on the bottom, we go goes to the aneurysm a little bit, and then out on these outflows. Synthetic data, so that we can compare how well they actually do. We did run this one on a bigger mesh, but then actually use observation just in a sub mesh, because that's what we actually have in reality. We don't see the observations of the entire body, but it's always just a sub part of the domain. And we added Gaussian noise to all the data that we use. So this is the synthetic data that we got from the forward modeling. Then here we have the added noise. So you can see there's actually quite a lot of noise that we added. And then this is the result that you get when we reconstruct. And we construct the solution with the data estimation. So you can see that actually it looks very nice. So it was after 32 awesome implementations. And then we moved on to a 3D case. So this is actual data from a dog. So what they've done is they've taken a dog and in the main artery, kind of artificially introduced an aneurysm-like board, and then took very high resolution imaging. So they used very strong contrast material and then the scan. So we have 70 measurements over one heart cycle, and we have, so this is the domain, so this is the, this is one snapshot of the measurements. So basically what we did is we use two solvers. One is a high-resolution focal solver, also implemented in Phoenix, that we consider as the state-of-the-art. So that's kind of 20 millimeters of freedom, pressure correction scheme P2P1, with a very small time step, almost three in outflow conditions that are kind of interpreted from the data that we have, 64 cores and 12 hours one time. So this was kind of our reference that we believe. It's good. It's the best modeling for one of the. And then we use our data version, data simulation solver, to be used a lot less user freedoms, because obviously you need to solve this over and over again. Using demand stabilization, quite a big large time set, order of magnitude larger. The initial control was just interpreted for measurements to get a good guess. We terminated the optimization after 22 optimization iterations because there was basically no change anymore in the functional. The functional reduced from roughly a factor of 4, and running this took 48 hours and 24 hours. So let's look at some results. I hope, this is quite tough to see. But basically, these are some slices through the 3D mesh. On the left, we have the observations, on the right, we have the high resolution solver. And if you, I'm going to click through this, and you should see that there is quite a lot of discrepancy, particularly here, in this area, between the observations and the model results. So just go backwards again. So here you can clearly see there's some clustering. So that was our high resolution model. And now if you use the data simulation solver, so hopefully you see this matches it very nicely. You don't, at least visually, it's not such. So the same thing again, just side by side, but it's basically the same such. Good. Then finally, we compare again how the mass conversation conservation works. So after the data simulation, obviously, we conserve mass as expected because we solve the PDE. But it's also interesting to see if you compare kind of the influx and the outflux. So the measurements, this is the measurement at the, for example, this is the left outlet. This is just the measurements interpolated, and this is after the data simulation. So you can see the data submission shows to slightly smaller outflows, just generally in this case. So this is kind of the discrepancy that we have if you do interpolation and this sort of regression data simulation. Right, and with that, I want to conclude. So basically, we showed that regression data simulation is feasible in 3D trains transient blood flow simulations. One of the really crucial parts is how you formulate the problem. So, particularly, which function do you choose, which localization do you choose, which observation operator do you choose. We have some assumption at the moment, so blood is really non-Newtonian, we use a Newtonian model. We use rigid walls, really, blood vessels actually do move a little bit. So there's also some assumption that we do here. The implementation of Phoenix-Dolphin was relatively straightforward. We had tricks, but then basically, I mean, it's quite a lot of code, so it's, most of it is just handling and feeding it the data. Yeah, and so this is specific to blood flow, but actually, I mean, the ideas are very generic, so this data information actually occurs in a wide range of problems, and I believe similar things can be used as well. Thanks.
A couple of questions quickly, then we'll get back in track with the team.
Simon, what was the Reynolds number?
So for the realistic hydrogen model used viscosity of 3.5, which is kind of assumed to be realistic. I think the Reynolds number is around 400. Yeah. And then for the low but so truly you get, so there's a big discussion right now, but it's assumed, that you do actually get transitional flow in the Anderson, so it's in the transition between laminar and turbulent flow.
And did you observe turbulence in your
No.
I guess the question then is, will these methods work if it's total? So I guess it's a universal problem.
Yeah. I actually don't think this it should be. Yeah, I think it depends on very much on the problem formulation. But for example, if your observation of that kind of averages over time, then I don't think that term is such a good issue. If your observation of that is in its instantaneous time slot, then obviously it can be very problematic.
It's
probably
yeah.
Yeah.
I was slightly puzzled by the fact that you threw away one third of the data. I understand why you did that, but that seems a pity. So if you now add an error to all the data and keep them all, then another way of phrasing without throwing away the data, maybe that the error actually is correlated so that you get the constant volume. That way you don't have to throw away one third of the data. You actually have more info.
No, we're not throwing away the data. It was the data's only used in the function.
Okay.
The function was the sum of the model observations and the data that we had.
Yeah.
It's just about what are the control buttons. So if you control the inflow and the outflow, and the other one you just leave open because it just derives from the control boundaries that we had. Yeah. So it's actually, you're fairly free to, you can choose any kind of control. So you're controlling the input and the output. You could have also controlled the two outputs, or maybe the input and the other output. But it doesn't really matter. But you're making use of all the data that you have.
And I think we're getting close to needing cool water. So maybe it could be any remaining questions.
Thank you very much. We reconvene at 11.
David?
Yeah.